Prakāsaya pratibodhitam bhagavata narayanena svayam vyasena gratitam purana munina madhye mahabharatam advaitam britavarshinim bhagavatim ashtadashadhyayinim Amba tva manusandadhami bhagavad gite bhavad veshinim Namostu te vyasa vishala buddhe pullara vindayata patna netra Yena tvaya bharata taila purna prajvalito Jnanamaya pradipaha prapanna parijataya totra vetraikapanaye Jnanamudraya krishnaya gitamritaduhe namaha Sarvopanishado gavo dogdha gopalanandanaha Partho vatsa sudhir bhokta dugdham gitamritam mahat Vasudevasutam devam kamsacha nuramardhanam Devaki paramanandam krishnam vande jagadguru Bhishma drona tata jaya trata jala gandhara nilotpala Shalya grahavati kripena vahani karnena velakula Ashwatthama vikarna ghora makara duryodhana vartini Sottirna khalu pandavairana nadikkai vartaka keshavaha Parasharya vachasarojamamalam gitartha gandhotkatam Nanakhyanaka kesaram harikatha sambodhana bodhitam Loke sajjana shatpadaira harahappe piyamana muda Bhuyad bharata pankajam kalimala pradvamsina shreyase Mukam karoti vachalam pangum langayate girim Yat kripatamaham vande paramananda madhavam Yam brahma varunendra rudra marutastun vanti divyarstavaihi Vedai sangha padakramo panishadair gayanti amsamagaha Dhyana vastitadadgatena manasappashyantiyam yogino Yasyantam navidussura suragana devaya tasmai namaha Om Mangalam sadhu veshaya shishya chitta vilasine Vidita akhila vedyaya moksha vigna vighatine Saumya kashi nivasaya deshikaya viragine Chaitanya nanda rupaya jivan muktaya mangalam Om sahana bhavatu sahana bhunaktu sahaviryam karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu ma vidvishavahai Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Shri Sadgurudev Maharaj Ki Jai morning. We are going to conclude our story. Yesterday we ended in the point that the Pandavas returned from the exile. They lived in the forest for 12 years, and then for 1 year they lived incognito. And by the end of this period, they returned and they demanded back their kingdom, but Duryodhana was not ready to give them anything. Duryodhana, you remember, is the eldest son of Dhritarashtra, the blind king. It became clear that there is going to be a big war, and each party started to send emissaries to the neighboring kingdoms to recruit support. They were asking the different kings to come and take part in this war to help them win over. They gathered huge armies, about 4 million soldiers gathered to this battle, you can imagine. It was probably the First World War, the real First World War. It was very big. There was one king that both parties really wanted his support. His name was Krishna. Krishna was a king who ruled in a place called Dwarka, and he had a very powerful army, a huge and powerful army. And Krishna was an avatar. We are going to discuss later on what is the meaning of an avatar. Basically, in a very short, avatar in the Hindu concept is a manifestation of the divine, manifestation of God on earth in a human form or in other form. But most people saw Krishna just as a normal person. They knew he was very powerful because in the past he fought very powerful enemies and he won over all of them. So both parties really wanted the support of Krishna, and both parties believed that whoever gets the support of Krishna and his army will win the battle. Therefore, they sent very important emissaries. The Pandavas sent Arjuna. Arjuna is the third son of Kunti, if you remember. And he was a very good friend of Krishna. They were about the same age. So they sent Arjuna to seek the help of Krishna and his army. The Kauravas sent Duryodhana. Duryodhana himself, the eldest Pandava, went to seek the support and the help of Krishna. It so happened that they arrived almost at the same time. First, Duryodhana arrived to Dwarka, to the palace of Krishna. He entered Krishna's room and he saw that Krishna is resting. Krishna is sleeping on his bed. He looked around, he saw behind the bed there was a big sofa. He went and he sat on the sofa waiting for Krishna to wake up. Then shortly after, Arjuna arrived. Arjuna enters the room, he sees Krishna is sleeping, he sees his cousin Duryodhana sitting there. He goes to the foot of the bed and he's sitting with joined palms waiting for Krishna. He was a friend of Krishna, but he also had a lot of devotion to Krishna. And he knew that Krishna is something special. He recognized Krishna's speciality, but he didn't know exactly who Krishna is. During the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna really realizes who is Krishna. We see it after chapter 11. Even before, in chapter 10 and 11, it is when Arjuna realizes who is Krishna. Anyway, Arjuna goes to the foot of the bed and sitting there waiting for Krishna to wake up. After a while, Krishna wakes up. And when he wakes up, he gets up, and because Arjuna is by the foot of the bed, as soon as he wakes up, he sees Arjuna and he says, "Oh, Arjuna, you have come to see me." And then he looks back and he sees Duryodhana and he says, "Oh, Duryodhana, you are also here. Why did you come?" Now, Krishna knew exactly why they came, because everybody knew. It was the hottest news on Facebook, and everybody knew. But still, just for formality's sake, Krishna was asking them, "What do you want, my dear cousins?" Because they were also Krishna's cousins. Kunti, the mother of Arjuna, was the sister of Vasudeva, who was Krishna's father. So they are really all one big family. Duryodhana tells Krishna, "Krishna, you know exactly why we have come. Both of us came to ask your support in the battle. I know that in your heart you like the Pandavas and you don't like us, but you are our relative just as you are their relatives. And therefore you should not show any partiality. You have to give us the same treatment. Now, I came first, before Arjuna, and therefore I have the first right to ask for your help, and it is your duty to join us in this battle." Then Krishna says, "Arjuna, what do you have to say?" Arjuna says, "Krishna, you know best. You do as what is right." Then Krishna says, "Okay, I want to help both of you. You, as you say, Duryodhana, both of you are my relatives, and I have a duty towards you. I'm going to help both of you, but I'm going to divide myself. One of you is going to get my army, the powerful army they will call the Vrishnis. The Vrishnis army is very powerful, thousands of warriors. One of you is going to get. The other one is going to get only me, myself. But I'm not going to fight. I'm not going to carry any weapon and fight this war, but I will be supporting the other one. This is the choice." And he says, "Duryodhana, it is true that you came first, but the first one I saw when I woke up was Arjuna. So I'm giving the first choice to Arjuna. Arjuna, what do you want? Do you want my powerful army or you want myself? But remember, I'm not going to fight." Immediately Arjuna says, "Krishna, I didn't come for your army, I came for you. Whether you fight or not, I don't care. I want you on our side. That will ensure our victory. I'm choosing you." And Duryodhana was very happy. Duryodhana just got even beyond what he could imagine. Duryodhana was afraid of Krishna. He didn't like Krishna. He wanted Krishna out of the way. And now he got both. He got the powerful armies of the Vrishnis fighting along with him. And he got the promise that Krishna will not fight. What else he could ask for? So Duryodhana is very happy. He's going back to his kingdom, very happy. Arjuna, before leaving, is turning to Krishna and saying, "My dear Krishna, I have an unusual request from you." Now remember, Krishna was a king. He was a very powerful king, very respected king. Arjuna is asking Krishna, "Krishna, since you are not going to fight in the battle, and since I want you by my side all the time, would you mind to be my driver? Would you mind to drive my chariot in the battle? It is just, imagine, it is just like you are asking, the President of the United States is coming to visit and you ask him if he don't mind to drive your car for you, to be your driver. It is something like this. But still, Krishna says, yes, Arjuna, I will be happy to be your driver, to be your charioteer, and I will be next to you in this war. So Arjuna is very happy, he's going back. And in the appointed day, two huge armies gathered in a place called Kurukshetra, which is in North India, a little north to Delhi, where is Punjab, Haryana today.
Is the place still there? The
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And they gather on two hills, and in between there is a big valley. Two huge armies, imagine, just 4 million soldiers, plus all the support and all the cooks, and so much. It was huge, tremendous. Everybody is ready for a great battle. Elephants and chariots and foot soldiers. It is early morning, and this is the point where the Bhagavad Gita starts. Actually, to be more precise, the war started. There was a war. And during the war, there was one advisor of Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra was the blind king. You remember, he was the ruler. And he had one advisor whose name was Sanjaya. Okay? And Sanjaya came on the 10th day of the war back to the palace to report to Dhritarashtra what happens in the battlefield. And the Bhagavad Gita is actually the report that Sanjaya is giving to Dhritarashtra. Okay? There was a sage, Vyasa, who gave Sanjaya a boon. He gave him this gift of the ability to have clairvoyance and clairaudience of the whole battlefield. He was able, imagine, the battlefield is not like something like this hotel. It's a huge area, you know. People were fighting on many different places simultaneously. But he got the vision to be able to see everything simultaneously so he can report to Dhritarashtra. And on the 10th day, he's coming back to the palace and report to Dhritarashtra what is taking place. And this is exactly where the Bhagavad Gita starts. And this is the time to open the Gita if you have. If not, it doesn't matter. And then we are going to start the study from the Gita now. Okay? Now, traditionally, the way to study the Gita is that first the teacher is chanting the verse and the students repeat after. Then the teacher is explaining every word separately and then translates the whole verse, then reads some commentaries and explain them, and then give a free explanation. This is the way normally it is done. We don't have the time to do it for 700 verses, right? But we will just do a little bit. So every class we will take one verse or two and we will try to do it together. So now the first verse, the first shloka of the Bhagavad Gita, we are going to chant it together. The way we do it is that I will chant a couple of words, and you repeat after me. Okay? When we finish, I will chant once the whole verse. Okay? So please repeat after me. Dhritarashtra uvacha.
Dhritarashtra uvacha.
Yeah, you can do better. Let's try once more. Dhritarashtra uvacha.
Dhritarashtra uvacha.
Dharma kshetre.
Dharma kshetre.
Kuru kshetre.
Kuru kshetre.
Samaveta.
Samaveta.
Yuyutsavaha.
Yuyutsavaha.
Mamaka.
Mamaka.
Pandavashchaiva. Kurvata,
Kima Kurvata,
Sanjaya,
Sanjaya.
Very good. Dhritarashtra uvacha, Dharma kshetre, Kuru kshetre, Samaveta, Yuyutsavaha, Mamaka Pandavashchaiva, Kima Kurvata, Sanjaya. This is the chanting, this is the meter of this verse. In the Bhagavad Gita, the whole Mahabharata is written like this in meter form. You can chant it. And there are a couple of different meters in the Bhagavad Gita. If you know them, you can chant the whole.
What do you mean meters?
Meter means the number of syllables in every line. Here, for example, we have 16. Right? Dharma kshetre kuru kshetre samaveta yut savaha. This is 16 meters. You see? In the same way, all the verses can be, you just open, you can chant. And then there is another one, another meter of 21 in each line. So, Vasamsi jirnani atavihaya navani grihnati naroparani tata sharirani vihaya jirnani anyani samyati navani dehi. This is the longer one. And this is dharma kshetre kuru kshetre samaveta yuyutsavaha. So it is all has to do with the number of syllables in every line. Okay? Dhritarashtra uvacha. Now Sanjaya arrives to the palace and approaches Dhritarashtra, the blind king. And Dhritarashtra uvacha. Dhritarashtra said, he asked actually. What he is asking? Sanjaya, ho Sanjaya. Kima kurvata. What did they do? Who? First, dharma kshetre, kuru kshetre. Those who were in kuru kshetra. Who were in kuru kshetra? The Pandavas and the Kauravas, right? The battlefield was taking place in kuru kshetra. Dhritarashtra is also calling it dharma kshetra. Dharma kshetra means the field where dharma or righteousness is being fought over. Okay? He said, in that Kurukshetra, where there is a battle over dharma, over righteousness, Samaveta Yuyutsavaha, assembled together for the sake of battle. Who? Mamakaha Pandavashchaiva. Mamakaha means mine. What are mine? My sons. The 100 sons of Dhritarashtra. He says, my sons, Pandavashchaiva, and the sons of Pandu, my brother. Kima kurvata, what did they do? Oh, Sanjaya. Now, from the question itself, you can already see the mindset of Dhritarashtra. Actually, the Pandavas were the step children of Dhritarashtra. You remember, they their father died when they were still young, when they were still children. And they came back to the palace to live with Dhritarashtra as his sons. He was supposed to look after them just as Kunti was looking after the children of Madri, if you remember. But Dhritarashtra had this attachment to his son, particularly Duryodhana, but all his sons. And he couldn't see the Pandavas of his own. And therefore he put this distance. Mama kaha Pandavaschaiva. My sons on one side and the Pandavas on the other side. Kima kurvata? What did they do, O Sanjaya? This is the question. Sanskrit. The language here is Sanskrit. Sanskrit is the ancient Hindu language. Most of the scriptures, the old scriptures, are written in Sanskrit. And Sanskrit is the mother of all the Hindu languages except one, except Tamil, which is a Dravidian language. But it is also the mother of the European languages. If you know, the world languages are divided into branches. So for example, Hebrew is a Semitic language. It comes from a Semitic branch. But all the European languages are coming from what is called Indo-European branch. Therefore, in many of your words are coming from Sanskrit. I don't know, I don't speak Norwegian, but English, like probably half of the words or more can be traced in one way or another to Sanskrit. It's not that the language is similar, it's not at all similar, but there are a lot of the roots migrated from India. So it is Latin and Sanskrit together are the roots for all the Indo-European languages. It's very, very interesting. Okay. Now Sanjaya is starting to talk. And actually for the rest of the scripture, until the end of the Gita, it is only Sanjaya talking. There is just the report of Sanjaya is the whole Gita. And what Sanjaya is saying? Sanjaya said, this is verse 2, having seen the army of the Pandavas drawn up in battle array, King Duryodhana then approached his teacher, Drona, and spoke these words. Sanjaya is starting his description by Duryodhana going to his teacher, Drona Acharya, and speak to him. What he says? Behold, O teacher, this mighty army of the sons of Pandu, arrayed by the sons of Drupada, thy wise disciple. We don't have time to read all the chapter, but I want to explain to you the importance of understanding the story in order to understand the Gita. Why Duryodhana is going to talk to his teacher, Drona, and what is he telling him? Who was Drona? Drona was the guru of the Pandavas and the Kauravas. When the Pandavas came back from the forest, they lived in the palace and they studied archery, politics, spiritual stuff and everything. And they had a guru whose name was Drona, Drona Acharya. Arjuna was Drona's Acharya's best student. But all of them, both the Pandavas and the Kauravas, studied from him. When the war took place, Drona favored the Pandavas. He really thought that Duryodhana is evil, is wrong. He really thought that Duryodhana should give the kingdom to the Pandavas, but Duryodhana was part of the army of the Kauravas. He was serving there. He was living in the palace in Hastinapura. He was part of the army. He was a citizen of Dhritarashtra's country. He cannot go and fight with the enemy. And this is something we see also today. Sometimes people serving in an army and they don't believe so much in the cause of that. We see it a lot with American soldiers that are going to Iraq, Afghanistan, and places like this. Not all of them accept this policy. Not all of them accept the cause of going and fighting faraway battles. But still, they cannot go and fight along with the Taliban because they don't agree with the American policy. Right? In the same way, Drona Acharya, even though he sympathizes with the Pandavas, he is obliged to fight along the Kauravas. But his heart is not in this war. And Duryodhana knows this. Duryodhana understands very well that Drona is not really eager for this battle. But Drona was very crucial. Drona was the head of the army. He was the chief of staff of the army. And his full participation was very important. So Duryodhana, who was very clever, comes to Drona and is telling him, "Behold, O teacher, this mighty army of the sons of Pandu, arrayed by the son of Drupada, thy wise disciple." Who is the son of Drupada? If you remember, Drupada is the father of Draupadi. You remember Draupadi, the princess who married the five Pandavas? Remember this story? Drupada is her father, and her brother is Drishtadyumna. I mentioned these names, you don't have to remember. Drishtadyumna was the chief of staff of the Pandavas army. He was the head of the army. Now, there is an episode earlier from the life of Drona that we need to hear about. When Drona was a boy, he went to the Gurukula. You know what is a Gurukula? Gurukula is like the school where the children go to live in the family of the guru and learn, study. Drona, when he was a boy, went to a Gurukula. In the Gurukula, there is no distinction between Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya. There is no distinction of rich and poor. All the children study together. And Drona, when he was a boy in the Gurukula, had a very good friend whose name was Drupada. Drupada was a prince and Drona was a brahmana, was a priest. They became very good friends. Very, very good friends. They were such good friends that one day Drupada told Drona, "You know, when you grow up, when we grow up and I become a king, I will give you anything you want. I will give you half my kingdom. You're just my best friend." But then, when they finished the Gurukula, each one went his own way. Drupada became the king. And Drona lived in another country and he got married. He got a son, Ashwatthama. And life was not very easy for him. He couldn't get enough money to survive. He was very poor. He didn't care about money, but for the sake of his wife and child, he needed something. His wife kept telling him, "You always tell me about your good friend Drupada, who is a king. Why don't you go and ask him for something?" So finally, Drona has no chance. He goes to the palace of Drupada. And when he sees Drupada, he's so happy. After so many years, he sees his old friend. And he says, "Oh, my dear friend, I'm so happy to see you after all these years. But to his great disappointment, Drupada is not at all receiving him warmly. He's telling him, who are you to call me a friend? I'm not your friend. Friends are only people who are equal. We are not equal. You have nothing. I have everything. How dare you call me your own friend? And when Drona hears this, naturally he's hurt. He's so hurt. He turns back and goes away. Yeah. He had such good memories. They were such good friends. And now he's coming and Drona is treating him so badly. So he decides that he is going to take a revenge. He goes, I will shorten it a little bit because it is a long story. He goes to a great warrior whose name is Parashurama, and he learns from him martial arts. He becomes the best archer, the best martial art teacher. And then he goes and
martial art is like a fighter?
Yeah, to be a warrior. Yeah. Swords and all this stuff. So then he goes and I'm trying to remember exactly. Yeah. Then he goes and he teaches the Pandavas and the Kauravas martial arts. He becomes their guru. And when they grow up, when they finish their Gurukula, at the end of your studies, you have to give a dakshina, you have to give some offering to your teacher. So Drona is sending Duryodhana and Karna. Duryodhana was the eldest Kara. Doesn't matter, even if you don't remember, it's okay. Karna is that brother, the first brother of the Pandavas who didn't know he was born for Kunti. She put him in the box. This is Karna. And Duryodhana is the eldest Kaurava. He sends them to capture Drupada. And they fail. And then he sends Arjuna, and Arjuna go and single-handed is defeating Drupada's army and captures Drupada and bring him back to the palace, where to bring him to Drona, humiliating him. And when Drupada is sitting there captured, he is waiting to be killed by Drona. Drona releases him. He said, oh, Drupada, I captured your kingdom. Now again we are not equal. Now I have everything and you have nothing. So we cannot be friends, right? So I give you back half of your kingdom. Now we are equal. We can be friends. And he releases him and let him go. Now, are they going to be good friends? No. Now Drona is feeling very bitter. Drona, he has a lot of anger and he hates Drona so much. He goes back home and he started to do tapas. He's doing austerity. And his aim is to get, he's praying to God that God will give him two kids, a boy and a girl. He wants a girl that will marry Arjuna and a boy that will kill Drona. This is his wish. He's doing a lot of tapas austerity and he's getting from God this boon. And indeed, two children are born to him. The girl is called Draupadi and the boy is called Drishtadyumna. Okay, so Draupadi indeed, as we heard, marries Arjuna, Right? So this wish was fulfilled. And now, Drishtadyumna is the head of the army, and he is destined to kill Drona. Okay? So now Duryodhana, I hope it is okay, not too many, you are able to follow me. It's a little complicated, I know. But I hope you are able to follow me. Now, Drona is reminded by Duryodhana, Drona, don't think that on the other side that our enemies are your beloved Pandavas. I know you like the Pandavas, but remember who is the head of their army. The head of their army is the person who wanted to kill you, the person who was born in order to kill you. And indeed, later on in the battlefield, Drishtadyumna kills Drona. This is really what happens. This way, Duryodhana is hoping that Drona will really fight. If he understands, if he forgets the Pandavas and remember his arch enemy, Drishtadyumna, he will really fight strongly. So this is the psychology of Duryodhana, and this is what Sanjaya is telling to Dhritarashtra. Is it clear? Somehow? All right. I'm just trying to tell you that this story is very evolved, it's very complex, there is a lot. If you want to really understand the Gita, it is important to understand the story. Okay? Anyway, I'm skipping a few verses. Yeah, we'll say many words about it, but not now, a little later. Yeah. I want to finish the story itself, and then we will talk more about that. Now we go to verse 20 in the first chapter. Then means something happened before. What happened before is that before the war starts, they used to make a lot of noise to scare the other army. Okay? So both sides started to make a lot of noise. They blow conches, they play drums, they create a lot of sound. And that sound is meant to scare the enemy. This is how they used to do before battles. So this already started. There was a lot of noise, a lot of sound. There was trumpets and everything creating tremendous sound. And in verse 20, we read, then, seeing the people of Dhritarashtra's party standing arrayed and the discharge of weapons about to begin, Arjuna, the son of Pandu, whose ensign was a monkey, took up his bow and said the following to Krishna, O Lord of the earth. Now Arjuna is seeing that the war is just about to begin, just about to start. So he turns to Krishna and he says, Arjuna said, this is verse 21, in the middle between the two armies, place my chariot, O Krishna, so that I may behold those who stand here desirous to fight, and know with whom I must fight when the battle is about to commence. Arjuna is asking Krishna, Krishna, just before the battle starts, please drive our chariot and place it in the middle between the two armies. I want to see those who are standing here today, eager to fight, eager to please Duryodhana. Sanjaya said, who is Sanjaya? He's the advisor, right? He is the narrator. Sanjaya is the narrator of the story. Sanjaya said, verse 24, Thus addressed by Arjuna, O Krishna, having stationed the best of chariots, O Dhritarashtra, in the midst of the two armies, in front of Bhishma and Drona and all the rulers of the earth, said, O Arjuna, behold these Kurus gathered together. Krishna is driving the chariot and placing it between the two armies. Then he turns back to Arjuna. He's pointing like this and he says, O Arjuna, look on all these Kurus that are gathered here together. Kurus can have two meanings. It refers to the Kauravas, right? The sons of Dhritarashtra. This is one army. But truly speaking, even the Pandavas are coming from the same dynasty, coming from the same lineage. So by saying Kurus, it refers to everybody. He says, look, all this one big family which is standing here today to fight. Very innocent sentence, but actually for Arjuna is a life-changing point. Suddenly, Arjuna's world turns over. Everything changes. Suddenly, Arjuna is completely, he's experiencing almost a nervous breakdown. He's completely disturbed by what he hears, or suddenly he realizes this war which is about to take place. And Sanjaya is saying, then Arjuna saw there in the army stationed fathers and grandfathers, teachers, maternal uncles, brothers, sons, grandsons and friends too. He saw his fathers-in-law and friends also in both the armies. The son of Kunti, Arjuna, seeing all those kinsmen thus standing arrayed, spoke this sorrowfully filled with deep pity. Suddenly Arjuna realizes that it is one family that is going to fight. Actually, you have to understand one point. Arjuna realizes that in front of him, against him, going to fight with him, are people which are most dear to him. One person is, we already mentioned, is Drona. Who is Drona? Drona is Arjuna's guru. What is a guru? Guru is your own teacher, is your root teacher, is like the probably one of the closest persons to you in your life. Arjuna is now supposed to fight against his guru. And then who else is there on the other side? Bhishma. Who is Bhishma? You remember? Bhishma is that brother of Arjuna's grandfather. You remember that boy who was first called Devavrata and then he took the vows not to marry and all this. You remember, right? Bhishma was one of the greatest warriors. He was very old at that time, but he was still very powerful. He was fighting along the Kauravas. He is like Arjuna's grandfather. Because Arjuna didn't have a grandfather. He was like Arjuna's grandfather. Imagine that your grandfather is standing in front of you and you have to fight and kill him. And truly, this is what happened. Ultimately, Arjuna had to fight against Bhishma and he killed him. So Arjuna realizes that his own relatives are on both sides and people are fighting one another, which is terrible. Then Arjuna said, to whom? To Krishna. Arjuna is turning to Krishna and says, seeing these, my kinsmen, O Krishna, arrayed, eager to fight, my limbs fail and my mouth is parched, my body quivers and my hair stands on end. The bow, Gandiva, slips from my hand, and also my skin burns all over. I am unable even to stand, and my mind is reeling, as it were. Arjuna is experiencing what today we will call a post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. Right? Today we have names for all this. But this is what this is a nervous breakdown. Arjuna is shaking, is shivering, he cannot think, he can hardly stand, he's crying, he's in a very pitiable situation. He doesn't know what to do. And I see adverse omens, O Keshava, I do not see any good in killing my kinsmen in battle. Arjuna tells Krishna, Krishna, I don't want to kill my own people in the battle. I desire not victory, O Krishna, nor kingdom, no pleasures. Of what avail is dominion to us, O Krishna, or pleasure, or even life? Those for whose sake we desire kingdom, enjoyments, and pleasures stand here in battle, having renounced life and wealth. Arjuna tells Krishna, Krishna, what is the point of this war? What? We want a kingdom? For whom we want the kingdom? Those people for whose sake we want it are going to die here. So what is the point in all this war? Why to fight? Why to kill? Those people for whose sake we are fighting, they are standing here, they are going to die. Teachers, fathers, sons, and also grandfathers, material uncles, fathers-in-law, grandsons, brothers-in-law, and other relatives. These I do not wish to kill, though they kill me, O Krishna. Even if these people want to kill me, let them kill me. I don't want to kill them. Even for the sake of dominion over the three worlds, leave alone killing them for the sake of the earth. Arjuna says, what is our gain? Just a piece of land? Why do we need to rule? What is this craving for power, for land, for possessions? What are we going to gain by it? By killing these sons of Dhritarashtra, what pleasure can be ours, O Janardana? Only sin will accrue to us from killing these felons. Arjuna says, if we kill these people, what happiness we are going to have? Is it not better just to step away, to give it up and go away from this battle? Therefore, we should not kill the sons of Dhritarashtra, our relatives. For how can we be happy by killing our own people? O Madhava, O Krishna. Though they, with intelligence overpowered by greed, see no evil in the destruction of families and no sin in hostility to friends, why should not we, who clearly see the evil of the destruction of families, learn to turn away from this sin, O Janardana? Arjuna says, Krishna, maybe they are stupid enough to go into war over such thing, but we know better. Why should we take part in it? We can go away and give it up. We don't need the kingdom. I'm skipping a little bit. Verse 45. Alas, we are involved in a great sin. In that we are prepared to kill our kinsmen through greed for pleasures of the kingdom. If the sons of Dhritarashtra with weapons in hand should slay me in battle, unresisting and unarmed, that would be better for me. Arjuna says, I'm not interested in this war. Even if they kill me, let them kill me. I will be unarmed. I will let them just do whatever they want. And Sanjaya concludes, having thus spoken in the midst of the battlefield, Arjuna, casting away his bow and arrow, sat down on the seat of the chariot with his mind overwhelmed with sorrow. So Arjuna, at the end of the first chapter, is in a very great distress. He is expressing it to Krishna, and he doesn't know what to do. Well, this is the end of this class. We are going to conclude here. And in the afternoon, in the next class, we will start off with chapter 2. Okay? So one moment of silence. Shri Sadgurudev Maharaj ki jai.